Top of the Sports Max Zone for this Monday. European football's governing body, UEFA, confirmed that a clerical error occurred earlier Monday, which resulted in the draw for the Champions League round of 16 having to be redone. After the confusion was addressed, this is what the computer served up for the knockout stage of the competition. Salzburg at home to Bayern Munich, Sporting Lisbon at home to Manchester City, Ajax, Benfica, Chelsea, Lille, Atletico Madrid against Manchester United, Villarreal against Juventus, Inter Milan facing Liverpool, and PSG facing who the Americans would call the winningest team in UEFA Champions League history, Real Madrid. The round of 16 will kick off on the 15th of February, and it is important to remind viewers that the away goal rule, which has been in place since 1965, has been removed. Instead, matches will now be settled in extra time or on penalties. Joining us now to discuss the draw, Brent Sancho. Brent, welcome to the Sports Max Zone. A lot happening this morning. Stunning and embarrassing for UEFA. What was your take on what happened this morning?
It brings back memories of sports day in Trinity College Junior in Trinidad and Tobago. It was that farcical where we had a mix-up as it relates to the small goal competition in Trinidad. That's, to be honest with you, Lance, it's the last time I've seen an error of such proportion. It was embarrassing, and as for much as UEFA has always trumpeted itself as one of the best in the region, in the world, sorry, as it relates to organization, their tournaments, of course, the UEFA Champions League and the European Cup. This was a massive mistake. And I think the only credit that I would give them, Lance, is the fact that they cleared it up and cleaned it up quite quickly.
Yeah, I was about to ask you that. The damage control, how impressed were you with that? Because it was hugely embarrassing, wasn't it?
It was swift, and I think they needed to be swift. I think if this had lingered a couple more hours, let's say 24 hours, I think then a lot of the skepticism would have grown, not saying that there's none there, but I think it would have gone to another level. Of course, teams would have started pointing and making accusations. Of course, we've heard many times about that warm ball that sometimes teams talk about in draws. But I was very happy that they turned it around quite quickly and they were able to redraw. I think at the end of the day, guys, I mean, from a draw perspective, unless you draw the same team like Chelsea did, I think everybody would either feel disadvantaged or some might feel advantaged. And that's the way draws are in football.
Yeah, the first draw, of course, serving up a Messi-Ronaldo clash with PSG and Man United, having the fans excited, at least temporarily.
Yeah, I was certainly excited, and I started to think that there had to be something a little bit more in that draw to have that, of course, both teams put together. But I think when you look at it, there's a lot of parity within, of course, the draw itself, the final draw, the real draw. And I think there are some teams that would be happy. Of course, if you are Paris Saint-Germain and Real Madrid, you wouldn't be that happy because, of course, you would have found yourself in a tougher situation than you were before.
Yeah, and Lance mentioned that mouth-watering clash that was actually very short-lived. Brent, from the actual fixtures that have been confirmed now, which would you say would be the match to look at, the one everybody will be tuned into?
Oh, that's Paris Saint-Germain against Real Madrid. I think it's going to be, and again, I'm always very cautious when you're talking about the Champions League draw. We've been doing it for such a long time here on SportsMax. That you can't really pick a winner now in a competition that starts February 15, 16, around that time, because a lot can happen in football, particularly with COVID and all these different things that are new to the equation outside, of course, of your normal injuries and lack of form. But the PSG and Real Madrid matchup is the one that I think most fans are looking forward to. I'm certainly looking forward to that one because both teams, I think PSG, you can go into different aspects of why it's such a great team. And of course, Real Madrid has been playing some great football in La Liga so far. So yeah, I think that match in particular is the one that I'm looking forward to.
And talk to me a bit about the Manchester United versus Atletico Madrid one. It's also another one I think a lot of people would be tuned into, very, very excited to look at. Ralf Rangnick at the helm for Man U. A lot of work to do from now till that particular match.
Yeah, and I think he would have gotten a full understanding as to his charges by then. He would have done the necessary rotation. He has quite a cumbersome fixture coming up here for Christmas. So he will find out a lot about the players that wear and don the red shirt. But don't count on Atletico Madrid. I know I've been quite harsh on them as it relates to their La Liga form and, of course, their Champions League form. I know we even mentioned that maybe Diego Simeone has gone past his sell-by date. But there's something about Diego Simeone and his Champions League and, of course, that particular Atletico Madrid team that it's a very, very tough draw. And that's a team that could show up on the day and cause a lot of problems to Manchester United.
Given Liverpool's excellence and Inter Milan's, well, they have shown quality in Serie A, but here's where the question is going. Do you think that the Inter Milan-Liverpool clash will lay bare the golfing quality between the EPL and the Serie A?
Yeah, and we saw it with the AC Milan clash, didn't we, George, with when it comes to, of course, Liverpool. And that was, I would consider a third-tier Liverpool team, if I was to be honest. And I think you would see that again in Inter Milan. But, you know, the thing that is remarkable about this fixture being in February is the African Nations Cup. And I want to feel both when I'm given my analysis of the Premiership and the Champions League, I want to suspect that the African Nations Cup may have some bearing in both competitions because players are going to be away for a lengthy period of time. Of course, we know what's happening with COVID and the travel that comes with it. And I feel that that tournament could be taxing on some of these team stars, particularly Liverpool, who's going to lose Salah and Mane for that tournament.
You know, let me talk about Bayern Munich and Salzburg, because here's the thing. I just think that Bayern Munich are a Robert Lewandowski injury away from coming back to the field. In other words, they have this Superman who, with him in their team, we tend to think of Bayern as invincible. But as we saw last season, when he was missing, then suddenly they couldn't buy a goal with $1 million. Choupo-Moting isn't the answer. And when Lewandowski isn't in the side, suddenly Thomas Muller looks like an ordinary footballer once again. And suddenly Leroy Sané gets inconsistent. And Kingsley Coman dribbles down dead ends. Lewandowski is that man that knits it all together. There must be a lot of finger crossing going on in Bavaria that the Pole stays fit, because you'll agree with me, Brent, without him, Salzburg would think that they have a chance.
And that's why I'm so cautious in making any predictions moving forward. And you hit the nail on the head, this particular team, Bayern Munich, because up until that time when he went missing due to injury, many of us would have probably put our house on Bayern Munich winning the Champions League then. And once he left, it was a completely different team. And you're right, going into a game against a very talented Salzburg team with a lot of emerging young talent coming to the foreway. And again, let's be honest, this Salzburg team will be looking at this fixture as a free hit because they're not expected to do much. But there is a lot of talent that can hurt Bayern. And if they are without Lewandowski, the man that brings everything together, and more importantly, scores the important goals for Bayern Munich, yeah, it could be a tricky tie. But as it stands right now, fingers crossed for the Bayern Munich contingent that he does stay fit, because I think without him, it could be an interesting one.
Only Bayern scored more goals than Ajax did in the preliminary round, Brent. Sebastian Haller out of his skin, 10 goals, a league leading 10 goals in the competition so far. What is true is that the year that Ajax almost went all the way to the final, it was a year where the teams didn't see them coming. Everybody has been watching them since that time with the individuals they have, the way they play. People are looking at them intently now. Can Ajax, you think, reprise the role of spoilers they played that year when a lucky Spurs knocked them out and prevented them from going through to that final with Liverpool? Or do you see them falling away the tougher the competition gets?
No, I think they are genuine dark horse in this competition, George. You know, funny, we talked about Haller, I think, a week or so back.
Yes.
And he made a statement saying that a lot of people may think that it's a step back in terms of moving from West Ham to Ajax. And he said, West Ham don't play Champions League football. So he's doing very well. And when you look at what Ajax brings to the table, I think when you compare them to the team that lost to Spurs, is they have a bit more experience in at this end of the competition within the ranks. And I think that would be the difference. And they seem to be hungry as well. They're doing extremely well, of course, in the Dutch league. And somewhere within that changing room, and of course there are rumors, let's not shy from this, there's rumors that the manager, Ten Hag, might be moving to Manchester United. Of course, he's one of the favorites to take the post. So when you put all those factors into this mix, I tell you what, that's a team that I wouldn't want to join if I were one of the big guns in this competition.
Yeah, of the unheralded teams, Brent, Villarreal, they are workmanlike in their performances. Teams, you get the impression, the bigger teams in Europe have to be at their very, very best. But thinness of squad may undo them. And perhaps by the time February comes around, there are some soldiers who would have fallen that would be critical to Villarreal going forward. But let's hope that everything stays even for them. Do they have the hunger? Do they have the tactical approach under Unai Emery to perhaps cause the shock in this round of 16, you think?
You know, as much as I'm a Juventus fan, I would suggest to you, George, that I think Villarreal are going into this one as favorites. Juventus have been very poor this season. And it's a situation that, of course, Allegri has been trying to fix. They've had one or two moments, but in the wholeness of what they've produced so far in the season, they've really struggled. And I think we've seen from Villarreal more than enough to suggest that they could, of course, go to Juventus and get a result and certainly bring them back to Spain and get a result. And we saw it against Manchester United, and we saw it throughout the group stages that Villarreal is a team, I think, have the ability. And if you look at all the fixtures, this is one in particular I feel that could go to Villarreal way. And it's simply down to the fact that Juventus have just not produced anything of major significance so far this season.
Brent, when the away goals rule was introduced, we all welcomed it because you had very, very cagey performances by teams on the road in European competition, and there needed to have been something to draw teams out of their shell. The men and women who made the decisions where football is concerned decided that it was right time to dispense with that because of the perceived disadvantage that it gave to some teams. I'm here thinking that with how football has changed, it is the perfect time to dispense with that rule and let the gladiators battle until somebody is separated by penalties or by the lottery of what happens in extra time.
Yeah, how many times we've seen teams go away from home and park the bus in front and hope not to concede and of course to sneak one in. We've seen that so many times. Look, this changes the way teams will approach games because it's quite straightforward. You have two football games that you have to win. And I think it augurs well for attacking football. It augurs well for open football. And it augurs well for teams now to present themselves in a way that you have to play to win football games. As you rightfully said, we've seen so many times in the past and so many examples of teams, of course, getting a result at home and then going away and parking the bus knowing that they would have had a favorable score at home, which would do enough to get them in the next round. So I think this is a good move in the sense of allowing openness of the football. And I think we'll see teams approach things differently. And that's what we want to see as fans. We want to see teams, both legs, play open football and have lots and lots of goals.
All right, time is up with us, Brent. But just I want to make sure I got you clear. You're saying that of the big teams in the round of 16, your Juventus are the most vulnerable on this day in sports.
Unfortunately, George, I have to concede and say yes, sir. Unfortunately, and Villarreal is a tricky outfit, and I of course understand that. And the way Juventus is playing, I'd be very surprised if they come out of that tie.
Excellent stuff. Thank you very much. All the best to you.
All right, guys. Have a great one.
Good, good, good. Lance Murray, you know that if this was the United States, that glitch in the draw would not have happened. And I'll tell you why I'm saying that. I've been to 4 or 5, maybe 4, of All-Star weekends. So I've been in the stadium seeing them rehearse for the All-Star game on the Sunday. So I've been in the stadium on the Saturday. Mm-hmm. Lance Mariah, they rehearse everything. So I thought that, all right.
But I thought that happens with this.
No, but that's the point I'm making. There are certain things that some organization would rehearse, the main things and everything. The Americans rehearse everything. Listen to this. There are some guys who will come into the stadium during the game and they'll throw T-shirts into the stands. Just throw T-shirts. Pick them out of a container, throw them. They even rehearse that. Now, if you can rehearse flinging T-shirts into the crowd, that shows you don't leave anything at all to chance. Once it is part of the program, they rehearse it. And I get the impression that not everything was rehearsed by UEFA, which is why it was so easy to correct and have it 2 hours later because of the fact that what went wrong was not a major thing. But it just goes to show you that attention to detail is important. I don't think we'd have been talking about a glitch if this were in the USA.
You know, you could have a point there, George, because I've been privy to some discussions with broadcast standards in the United States. as opposed to how they operate in Europe. And there was one particular bit of information that startled me a bit, where some top Europe-based football commentators, who we know well, if I call a few names, you would know who we're talking about, went to work with an American outfit. And they were a little bit unsettled by the number of rehearsal procedures that they had to go through, because in Europe, they wouldn't have done that.
Nope.
So there is a point to be made there.
Yeah, what I do know is the embarrassment that UEFA had today, this probably won't happen in a long time again. They will start rehearsing all these different things that you're talking about, George. Break time.